Good day to you. You know, you live in a country, so you think you know it, right? Especially in terms of its media system. You think you know about the US media system because you live here, right? Well, mostly that's true, but also one of the advantages of taking on the country that you live in terms of its media system by studying other countries' media systems is you do end up learning a lot more about your country because you have that comparative basis. So even though you've grown up in the US, we have a whole chapter on US media. I won't be covering that chapter in as much detail as I cover other chapters because other chapters are more novel. They're from other countries. But still, I want to make some points about the US. So let's start off with some introductory comments here. The US can be characterized by both consolidation. That's where fewer companies are owning more properties. Consolidation coming in together. That's one feature of the US media system. And the second feature, which you'll also find happening across other countries that we will study in this course, the other feature is new competitors. And the new competitors are mostly technology companies. You know, the Googles, the Facebooks, big tech that they're sometimes called. Even Amazon you can throw into this picture as well. Certainly Amazon. So we've got these two industries, the traditional legacy industry competing with, mashing with, having trouble reconciling with, and also finding synergy with the new technology competitors. Essentially today, to illustrate the consolidation, at least in terms of the television industry, if you look at the top 10 television channels that are viewed on cable, what are the top 10 cable channels? 9 out of the 10 of those are owned by 5 companies in this country. So almost all of cable TV watching, you can say, is being done only by accessing 5 different companies' media content samples. So now let's go on to talk about U.S. entertainment media across platforms. And we know that entertainment content that's produced on one platform, like film in a TV, in a movie theater, that can then migrate to other platforms. And that's really what it's all about, is getting media content to go to other platforms so that media content reaches different audiences. And in some cases, audiences purchase the same media content twice. That's actually once. You know, that's actually what you want, people purchasing the same stuff twice. You know, so people will purchase a film by going to see it in a movie theater, and then if they really want to show somebody else the film that they saw, which was so great, their only choice is to rent it out or to get it through a subscription service like Netflix. That's paying for it twice. Same with a jukebox in a bar. You put quarters in, people go and put quarters or put debits on their card and choosing the same songs over and over. That's one of the keys to a successful media profit-making formula. Now, entertainment products, not just in the US, but across all of the countries that we're talking about, they are costly. They're very costly to produce. I mean, on the television side of things and the radio side of things and the film side of things, you need producers, you need writers, you need performers, you need editors, you need all kinds of other people in between, production assistants, and it takes time. You have to go out and rent facilities. You have to depend on weather. You have to bring in extras. Producing media content is extremely expensive, and that's why you need to spread it across different platforms so that you keep revenue coming in from different ways. In the United States, the film industry is very large. We will find out later. I'm not going to tell you now, but there is another country that produces more films than the U.S. But here in the U.S., the major film studios, not the minor ones too, but the major ones, they're putting out about 100 films per year. Now, looking at that motion picture industry, the business model for the United States back in the 1970s, to some extent in the 80s, used to be that there was this very, very exclusive window, it was called. And so if a new film came out like Jaws was a blockbuster in the 1970s, you could only see it in the movie theater. You could only see it in the movie theater, and it would have a run for, I don't know how long it was, maybe it was 6 months, maybe it was a year. And then after that, there was actually a prohibition from exhibiting Jaws in any other platform for 6 months, for a year, and then it could migrate to theaters in other countries. And then when it was going around theaters in other countries, then the exclusive window opened up for Jaws to be shown on television. And then from there, it's going to move over to Netflix and Hulu and all the other places. So The exclusive window that used to exist is no more. Today, because of competition, you will find films that are released both in the movie theaters and on the internet at the same time. Now, it doesn't mean that that window is not there. There are staged releases of some products that still take place, but it's not like it used to be this long, drawn-out time period before you could see something after its first run. Similar to television, we had a similar story here, a television program that was produced. It had to wait a while before it could go into what was called syndication. Syndication is where a major network produces a TV show, and then once that show is done, all the actors move on to another show. It finishes, has its final episode. Then it can be sold as a package to a cable channel or to a more minor broadcast network like the CW network or to like a cable channel like Lifetime. And so here we're seeing TV content also going through different platforms. And like film, there used to be an exclusivity window before a TV show that was originally broadcast on NBC could then be shown in syndication. But all that is given away to a shorter time frame as well. So now we're going to talk about U.S. entertainment content going out not just across platforms, but across industries now. So Disney is the most well-known media property in the world, mostly through its film productions, but also through ABC and ESPN Sports. But Disney was one of the first media companies to branch out into other industries, specifically theme parks. So Disney has its Disneyland and its Disney Worlds, which are located in Florida, Hong Kong, and France, and other places. These are going out across industries. And you can find this is similar to the case with Comcast. If you go down and watch the Flyers play down in Philadelphia, you'll see the big Infinity building, because that's a brand that's going along with Verizon, which is also tied in with Comcast. And it's another example of how another industry, telephony, we call it, which is telephones, is brought into the media industry. I've got my cell phone here. I can watch stuff on my phone. It's coming to me, though, from my cell phone provider. It's another way of showing how content might start out as a TV show, and it's spreading across not just other platforms, but other industries into telephony. And in fact, cable itself was a different industry than broadcasting. They used to be two separate industries. Broadcasting is over the airwaves. It's terrestrial. You got to have an antenna and a line of sight to the transmitter. That's how you get broadcast media. Cable's totally different. It's through cables. Video on demand, yet another industry. This is it's taking advantage of the interactivity of the internet, where the person who wants to watch things can choose the media content at their own timing when they actually want to see it. Now let's go on to talk about U.S. regulation. You know, regulatory bodies I have a fascination with. I don't expect my students to have such a fascination with them, but they're very interesting to me because it's those bodies that decide the yeses and the nos to media production. What is a yes? What is a no? For example, the word fuck is a no under our media regulation, unless it's going to be played on a Netflix show, or it's going to be streamed, basically. If it's broadcast, no, your station's going to get a fine. So where do regulations come from in the U.S.? Well, the main body for broadcasters is the FCC. You know that, right? The Federal Communications Commission. But then we also have, did you know, the FTC, the Federal Trade Commission, which makes rulings on the cost of advertising across state lines, for example. So we have the FTC. We've also got the Department of Justice. The Department of Justice rules on mergers and acquisitions. Like we have a big merger that went through, a big acquisition that went through last year. It's actually talked about in this book chapter, but it took 2 years before it was approved. And that's the acquisition of AT&T and the Warner Company, previously the Time Warner Company. So the Department of Justice is also a regulator. And then we've got Congress itself. Congress can pass laws. Do you know Congress has passed a law called the Right to Reply Law? And that means that if you're a politician and you get invited on a TV show and you're running for office, then if you're a competitor to that politician, you should also get invited on that show if you have just as good a chance at winning that election, so that the TV show is not, or the TV station is not, biasing one particular candidate. Now let's move on to talk about U.S. entertainment media across borders. You know, the U.S. has been reaching out across borders for years. I can remember in the 1970s going to England with my parents, where they were from, and watching lots of American TV shows. Already American television was having a presence going overseas, but it's only accelerated. You can go to the smallest village as long as it has a movie theater in Africa, in South America, in Asia, and you're going to find a regular TV film, a regular American film that's running in that TV theater. That's how long the reach is of the film industry. And certainly on television, if you go to watch French TV, English TV, German TV, you can find tons of American sitcoms, crime shows, reality TV shows, even sports in prime time. You know, in Mexico, when the NFL is in season, they actually use their movie theaters to show US NFL games. So the process of reaching across borders for American media content has only been accelerated by Netflix, which is all over the world, and by the way, has different copyright permissions depending on the country. You can't watch the content you watch in the US necessarily in Mexico. Can't watch the content in Mexico necessarily in Canada on Netflix. There are copyright agreements, licensing agreements. And also Amazon Prime is in the mix here as well as spreading American media content across the world. So now let's wrap things up for the American entertainment industry by talking about challenges that the entertainment industry faces in the future, including achieving appropriate scale. What that means is, did you ever hear that you have to reach critical mass before something just continues? That's what we're talking about here with scale. You have to become big enough in the US entertainment industry. You have to control your distribution. You have to have so many different media content products to offer. You have to have financing. You have to have organizations spread throughout the country, networks or connections through satellite. That's what you have to achieve to be a successful media property in the United States at scale. You have to become big enough. It's not just enough that look at Twitter. Twitter, very popular. Lots of people use Twitter. Sports people use Twitter, news people use Twitter, college students use Twitter. Still not profitable. Has not reached that scale yet. What does it have to buy? What does it have to end up with as far as crossing over to another platform before it's going to become a viable profit-making company? Challenge number two is competition, because it's so fierce, is a zero-sum game in the United States. It means there's no two winners. You have one winner. One person wins and the other person does not. That's why, for example, we only have one cable company here in Monroe County, Blue Ridge Communication. For another company to come in here and build out the infrastructure of a cable lines, strapping those lines all across telephone poles, installing a head end with all the satellite equipment to receive programming, and hiring technicians and vans to go out and service people, it's a multi-million dollar investment. No other company is going to come in here and take a chance. So the company that wins in this market area, it's Blue Ridge. Zero-sum game, nobody else wins. And then along with that is our final challenge, and that is companies that do want to compete in the US media market, including entertainment media, they have to have both breadth and depth. Breadth refers to the many different types of media content products that they offer: films, TV, rock and roll songs, web pages, etc. That's breadth. But then you also have depth. You also have a different means of distributing it through different components as part of the company, an ownership group, and you have subsidiary companies, and then they have smaller subsidiaries, and then they have outside agencies that they hire outsourcing, and they have freelancers. That's that vertical or depth that companies have to have today to be able to compete. You need both breadth and depth. And that will wrap up US Entertainment Media. Have a great day.